But I'm also sole proprietor of Tremonti Solutions LLC, which is an educational consulting company.
And my friend.
And Talia's friend.
Add that, thank you. So super excited to talk about his business and also his position. As you all know, we are in a higher ed. Shout out to higher eds. Shout out to union-held workplaces. You already know the vibes. Big news yesterday. So for those of us who are Black and brown in higher ed, it is a unique and fun experience, is it not?
Most definitely.
Okay, so talk to me about your business. Why did you name it that? And then secondly, why did you go to work at a SUNY? Specifically at UB, which I'm a graduate of.
Okay. Well, so I think I'll flip it and take the SUNY question first. So coming to University of Buffalo, SUNY School, is a bit of a homecoming. I did work there before at Educational Opportunity Center.
That's awesome.
I taught adult ed there. It was super dope.
Cool.
You know, I can't remember the name of the program, but I met a ton of young ladies, young people who were serious about getting their high school equivalency. I worked there for 3 years, left the position.
Help people, talk about that. Change lives.
Right. We won't talk about that.
That's okay. So now you're back.
Yeah. Here
and
I
you're
am,
a boss. Right? You're a director. Talk to us about that. Are you in a union, sir?
Yes.
UUP. You're in my union.
You down with UUP? Yeah,
bienvenido.
You know me.
Tu sabe. We over here union chilling. Okay, so what is the name of your business and why?
So the name of my business or company is Tremonti Solutions.
Okay, why?
Tremani. I named it Tremonti because my son.
I knew this answer. Go
ahead. Trey is his name. And my daughter's middle name is Imani, Naya Imani. So I just put them together, Tremonti.
And then can you say what a brilliant artist your daughter is?
Well, that definitely goes without saying. I wish I could show you some pictures. I'm always showing her pictures.
Well, we'll tag her. We'll tag her or share her content.
Yeah.
Okay, so you named after your children and you went to go work at University of Buffalo because you used to work there and now you're coming back in a leadership position, which you were in a leadership position before, but leading like an institution, like a part of the institution. So talk to us about working just for the graduate school of education. So like, what's that like?
So,
or can you explain what the Graduate School of Education is?
Yeah. So at University of Buffalo, the Graduate School of Education, I think I kind of bleed in what you said. Hi, y'all. I want to bleed in.
Oh, you're so selfish here.
I want to bleed in on like that original question of me coming back.
Okay.
And one of the reasons why I accepted the role is because of the work that the Graduate School of Education has done, and especially in terms of hiring.
Okay.
I did some research on who they brought in, and I saw that some of the professors define themselves as scholar activists.
Okay, that's beautiful.
Look that up. Scholar activists.
So if you're listening, scholar activists, I've heard of a lot of different scholars, like sports scholars and stuff, but never putting it in that tense. So you're part of an institution, a place that's forward moving, correct? You're excited about working with your colleagues. What is the thing that makes your day special? So talk to us about how long you've been there, and then also how long have you had your business?
So I've been at UB in this new role all of less than 2 weeks. This is my second
welcome
week
to the union.
Yeah. So Tremonti Solutions existed for at least 10 years. I had it as a DBA, and this is the first year I turned it into a LLC.
Okay, so talk to me about that journey. When you decided to make it a DBA, why and what were you intending to do with it? And then how and why did you decide to make it an LLC? And explain for the audience, Mr. Green, what a DBA is, please.
So here we go. I've been knowing Talia for a long time. We always stay authentic,
right? A very long time.
I made it a DBA because I was just trying to get some money, and I knew that if I made it a DBA, I could get a bank account associated with a bank.
That's fantastic. How did you know that?
Research, talking to
people. How old were you at that time?
Oh, probably. This was probably right when we started at Say Yes together. So maybe a little bit before that, 2015. Okay. 2014. Yeah.
So at some point, everyone's like, I have this skill, I do this thing I love, and now I'm going to turn into a business, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you made that decision. You were like, okay, you're going to do a DBA. And then you were like, okay, hey, sweetie, how are you? We're going to do an LLC. Give me 1 second. So if you want to hang out, and then we're on, and in 15 or 20 minutes, okay? Just move my first second. My other guest is here. We're going to have an exciting show. Y'all are not ready. Thank you, dear. So one of the things I think is important, right, is to talk about how you define yourself within the company. What is your role? Do you call yourself the CEO? Are you the founder? What are you?
I mean, I guess I would be the CEO, the founder.
The CEO, the founder, the owner, the dueño.
Primary lead instructor, primary developer, because basically I do it all by myself. I do contract out certain folks in the academic field to make sure that my stuff is as evidence-based and verified. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, yeah, absolutely. But
no, I do everything.
Everyone loves evidence-based practice.
Yes.
Okay, fantastic. So talk to us a little bit about where you see the future of your business and then also what you hope to do with your position. And again, you're the director of outreach and community engagement. Y'all, he came in and gave me his card.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Jazz says fire. The director of community engagement, and you are at the University of Buffalo, specifically at the graduate school.
Yep.
And shout out to the law school, of which I am a graduate of.
Hey.
Hey.
I think they're right downstairs from us.
Oh,
currently.
Probably. Yeah. We have a really, really good forward motion and spirit at the law school. So if anyone has or wants information about how to get there, specifically SUNY UB, hit us up. We have an open line, and or you can find me in many a cajillion places. So talk to me about your future. What does that look like for you?
Well, you know, with UB, I just want to help them grow and become really a university that is connected to the community and a part of the community, and folks in the community can access the university in many different ways and avenues, not just for a degree, but access the space, access the resources for future development. In terms of my business, Tremonti, man, listen, whew, we doing some things in Tremonti.
Are you excited?
I'm excited because, you know, authenticity. I grew up with hip hop.
Okay.
I understand the transformative.
Wait, because you were going to say like you had a funny story about this.
Oh,
place.
No. Yeah, the funny story.
That.
So to be at WBNY, and all my real heads are know, if you on Instagram or wherever you listening on the radio station.
Right.
1986 through 90, 91, 92, before I left to college, WBNY was my source of real hip hop.
Right. I feel like we were like one of like, we were like the first or second or third or fourth like station to play Drake. Like,
man, well,
we played him very early.
I'm talking that Drake wasn't even born then.
I know,
probably.
Sweet. Neither was I, but that's not his point.
Public Enemy.
Yeah, they played my brother on this radio station too.
Like
this,
DMC,
it's always been
LL.
Like a good place for like underground, up and coming music.
Big
so,
Daddy Kane,
right? And actually, I have the ability in the show and other shows to like play music. And the intro music is actually my brother.
Okay,
it's one of his songs. But then,
Joey Blanco.
Yep, Una de la Caserío. One of the girls that volunteered with me over summer camp, I had her speak over the song, and she says, Latinas make history every day. Because I think that was one of the premises that I wanted to reiterate to myself when I step forward to have like a media personality or to be in the public light, is that like my demographic needed a voice, right? And like we needed to be at the mic. And I feel very much like that for you about you being Black in higher ed. And I think that's amazing. So talk to me about what your peer group is like. Who are the people that you look up to and or collaborate with when you are looking to make educational change? And also, how do people get in a hold of you?
Okay. So any and everybody that I come in contact with, I try to pull in to amplify my work, to
okay.
connect at UB, to develop program, develop capacity at Tremonti. I mean, you know, you asked like where I see myself in University of Buffalo.
Yeah, like what are you hoping to do?
Oh, well, just expand.
That's awesome.
And like I said, make folks understand and recognize that our culture is a viable academic tool.
Right.
You know, quick right. question. How do you define Black genius in the context of white supremacy?
Myself every day, like
exactly.
just waking
it's
up.
It's a trick question.
But,
you don't define
but
Black
I guess
genius in that context.
Flip question. How do you define gender equality in a system of patriarchy? So here we are. One of the things
Can
that I
that?
No, one of the things that I think is interesting is that you are education consultant, right? So a lot of people don't realize there's a lot of businesses that either make money, right, or generate income, generate economic activity around just learning. So that's fantastic. Talk to me a little bit about what your services are like, or if you were interfacing with a client, what would be like the things that you're most proud of that you do? Because I know you've trained teachers, you've set up spaces. I mean, I've seen you do amazing things. So tell us, what are you marketing?
Yeah. So actually, the funny thing is, I'm not necessarily marketing.
Okay, what's your skill set?
All of my contacts or connections have been through word of mouth.
So he doesn't need to advertise, y'all. And if you have a good reputation like that and a very special skill set, you will not have to either.
But a couple things that I did this past year that I'm very proud of. I had a contract with the city of Buffalo to do training preparation for the firefighters entrance exam.
Shout out to our Black Mayor.
Yeah, most definitely. So we saw 400 participants come through. That's cool. About a 98% positive approval rate for the after report surveys.
Who wrote the evaluation, Mr. Green?
I didn't write the evaluation.
I'm just teasing.
The participants. I mean, the biggest thing about that is like, so I went out on New Year's and people, I never go out.
I know that.
Yes.
For those of you who are listening, he never goes out.
Yes. And a young brother approached me. He's like, yo, were you the guy that did the prep for the firefighter exam? I'm like,
oh,
yes.
Oh, that's awesome.
Most definitely. He told me he scored. He's 125th on the list. And he's waiting to get called for his physical fitness exam.
Shout out to him.
Yeah. But also working with school districts. Right now, a lot of clients are school districts. Me working specifically with schools to address issues of cultural and racial conflict. Okay. And identify ways to create creative ways to address those things within the context of the school.
I love that. I think one of the things that's important to me as a Latina is building what I call identity affirming spaces, which is really like whether they are economic, academic spaces where people feel like their culture, as you alluded, is a virtue and will like help, right? And then also that it's something to be explored from an academic perspective, because I was having a conversation with a data specialist yesterday. She was like, well, there's so much data. And I was like, actually, I feel understudied. And for Latinas, right, there's not really that much data in the structure in which we are researched and who we're researched by and how the evaluations are presented. And she just looked at me like, whoa. And I was like, yeah, I'm present. So I'm super excited that you're going in and helping people, because I think that you need that lived experience to be able to create those environments, because, you know, they really come from the heart in my mind.
Most definitely. Well, I think what you said you want to create, you've created here. The conversation
we had
prior to coming here, I was like, can I dress hood? You was like, yeah.
You never have to ask that to any of the places that I'm going. You can just literally dress up. Like, that's fine.
Show up.
That's how I dress. So like, please welcome. Also check my platinum hair that I got on Amazon. So with all of our hoodness, between the two of us, let's list our degrees. What do you got going for you? What are your credentials, Mr. Reed? Let's hear it.
I really don't even like it. Master's, bachelor's in
Don't do that. Master's in what, and how did you earn it, and where?
Master's of educational leadership, and I ain't gonna lie, I got it at University of Phoenix because I had two kids.
Okay, that's fantastic. See, now that's something to share. A dog.
I had two kids and a dog.
Okay.
And three jobs.
That's fantastic. And you went to school online?
Yeah, went to school completely online for 2 years, yeah.
Okay, that's fantastic. And then what did you do prior? Where was your academic study prior? I can answer this question, but go ahead.
Alfred University.
Yes, yeah, Sarasuni.
Yep.
What's up?
Mm-hmm. Alfred University, Bachelor's of English and Secondary Education, and a minor in coaching.
Okay, that's fantastic.
That I never use, but...
You do use. You coach people all the time.
This is true.
And then you did something that I think was really fantastic. You started a 3-on-3 basketball tournament.
Oh, man.
Because that was one of your friend's super good ideas that she encouraged you to do, but you actually implemented and was amazing. Talk to us about that.
You know, we all share ideas as educators. There are no inventors.
Talk to us about that.
I mean...
There are no original ideas, big fact.
First of all, big shout out to you, because... Everybody did some amazing
random
things.
Shout out. Big shout. We should say what we're talking
schools.
About. Okay, so we worked together for way too long, for way too many hours over the course of about 2.5-3 years building the infrastructure for an educational-based program that really turns schools into community centers and support centers over the weekend.
Man, you better say that. Say yes, Buffalo Community Schools.
He said you better say that.
For all of those who attend community school events and Saturdays.
Humbly.
Understand. And right now is two of the major architects of that program.
We
Congratulations. Well,
facts.
Thank you. And Will, we were walking through New York City and we were thinking about the magnitude of the budget and the magnitude of the task at hand, because it was 2017 and in my neighborhood, there were many children that needed a lot of support. And I remember opening the door and having hundreds of refugee and new American youth be there and me just feeling a feeling of gratefulness, because I knew that's what my Nana and I knew that's what my neighbors wanted that school to be when it was opened in 1899. Shout out to Lafayette, the Violets.
Mm-hmm.
PS 207.
I mean, so really everything you said there, once again, it's like you speaking what you've done and your destiny, because it was that type of attitude that had me chasing your numbers. Like, she was getting 500,
well, we had a lot of people
coming through
to my events.
And I'm
to
like,
my events. Well, no, because 150. Also, like, okay, so Will and I both decided to take a course where we went to work inside our neighborhood. And when you do that, right, a lot of times you absorb collateral trauma, but you're also living in the social realities that you're trying to solve, prove, or build around. So I remember when they said they were going to keep the school open on Saturday, I started texting some of my cousins and like, mira, nena, el yo dije que voy a desayunar. There's about to be breakfast in here. You better text the rest of the Puerto Ricans. Because I think one of the things that I really started there that ultimately helped me in this role presently work with my neighbors to build a food pantry, which is one of the most humbling things I've ever done, period, other than be a mother, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is because we were feeding people. So when I was talking to people about why they should come to school on Saturday and they was looking at me crazy, I was like, no, but there's gonna be French toast.
Mm.
So you need to come. But you did amazing things. Talk to me about the 3-on-3 tournament. And mm-hmm. then we are going to, I'm gonna ask you two more questions. And then our guest that's right behind us, I wish you could just like join.
Man, but we can pull over, yeah, we'll let him come on.
We have an amazing young person here that I'm super excited to talk with. So last two questions, okay? Talk to me about 3-on-3. Mm-hmm. What was that like? And for you at that stage of your career as a academic professional, what did that mean to you to be able to see that implemented?
I mean, so really, you know, community schools just offered an opportunity for me to take all the experience and know-how that I had and implement it within my own community. You were the West Zone leader.
Yes.
Right? Specifically on the West Side.
West Side.
And I was the East Zone leader.
Specifically on the east side,
on the east side, East just Zone Strong.
With a yeah. Oh, right? First of all, we had t-shirts. Y'all yes. don't know how we worked hours and hours. I'd be texting him at 1 a.m. like, what do you think about this? 2 a.m. we got to be at the office in 6 hours. But we didn't care, because I think one of the things we wanted to do was prove that schools could be a resource.
Mm-hmm.
And once we were able to set up the programs and the infrastructure that demonstrated that, it became this enrichment opportunity. Like, right. Now this actually works. What do we do to make this fun?
Mm-hmm. And I like to think we made other folks jealous of what we had going on in the hood.
I think when I ran the legal clinics, people also felt like that. Mm-hmm. I've had people from Niagara Falls.
It's okay to be jealous of us.
Well, people from Niagara Falls and Lackawanna be like, oh, I wish TAS was out here. I wish there was a legal clinic out here. I wish there was a mental health mm-hmm. clinic out here. So shout out to them and Cotil and all the people who brought that organization here and who are presently working in it. I want to give my producers an opportunity to reflect. They always are very bright and say very good things.
Yeah, I wanted to actually ask Will Green, and I love your name because I'm a
I
Will.
Can't hear him.
Yes, you can. Put your headphones
can
on.
Can you hear me? Yeah. He should have been had his headphones on.
He doesn't have
that.
His headphones on. He's just talking and can't even hear himself.
It's all good.
Yeah.
Okay, so
if
you
mind
going
go ahead. Will Green, I like your name because I'm a Will too.
All right.
Willie. But
yeah,
Will Green, your business, tell us your business again and let me know if it's an LLC because I want to ask you questions on that.
Yeah, so actually it is an LLC, Tremonti Solutions.
Right. Well, LLC is Limited Liability Corporation.
Right, and that's awesome, Will, because now Will, have you been able to get contracts or subcontracts because you LLC? Because I know you're capable because
so
you set up.
I've been doing the work under my DBA. I just got my LLC official.
Good.
I think, and big shout out to Crystal People Stokes. She had an
big
event
Lepa.
At Northland Corridor.
Yeah.
Where if you came in with your information, you could get registered.
Oh,
as
is
an
that
LLC
where you met
right
Jazz?
Here. I've known Jazz for a while.
So can anybody do that now? Because that's good. That's good information
you know,
you've given.
I mean, you know, I have contact with her office, and you know, I'm gonna definitely plug her because that was an awesome event.
Oh yeah,
it's a
that's
few
great.
Things you got to take care of to finalize it,
right.
But it can happen. But in terms of subcontracts, I mean, the sky's the limit. Once you understand what the rules are and you
right.
have a business to operate from,
right.
I think I've subcontracted with my daughter already. Talia mentioned she's an artist,
she's,
so I use genius for a artist. Lot of stuff.
Wonderful.
Yeah. Oh, and for those of you who are listening, just to play catch up with some of the language, subcontract is when you come in and you work for someone and you provide a service or a good underneath their umbrella of liability under a contractual relationship that's pre-existing.
That means more money, guys.
Right. And my lawyer talk.
I love her legalese, though. Listen, yeah.
Don't let the blonde hair fool you.
Genius, right?
Don't let the blonde hair fool you.
People
and
don't
then
even understand.
The other thing too that I'm really excited about is talking about why you made that decision. So, to my producer's point, there's a lot of incentives once you're an LLC.
Right.
We have a small business association here, mm-hmm. and then guys, let's switch over at 10:45 because I have the next guest here. So
okay,
that's
gotcha. We'll switch over 10:45.
Okay. So we are super excited just to just be in this space to talk about Mr. Green's business for those of you who are joining us on Instagram and other places. And we're talking about why, as a leader, as a community leader, as a dad, as many of your hats, you decided to file an LLC. What was that day? What was that moment like? And then what were you hoping to gain, as my producer alluded to, by having that corporate structure?
So honestly, to move from a DBA to the LLC for me was, number one, I wanted to be official. I wanted to protect myself from liability, because that's what happens when you set up
the big
a corporation structure. Like, you know, so if somebody sues me, my personal assets can't be impacted. They can only, you know, come after assets
so
of
it's
the company.
Some yeah. insulation from liability.
Mm-hmm.
People like to throw around the word indemnification, one of my favorite words. And one of my relationship terms.
Okay.
And it shouldn't be.
Relationship terms. Yeah. Hold up.
Indemnification.
Hold up. What does that mean?
It means terms I use when I'm talking about relationships.
Wow. I mean, you mean like somebody.
Like romantic relationships. Indemnification.
Oh, my
yes.
Lord.
But,
she's a real lawyer, y'all.
Yes,
man,
I am.
I'm telling you. Beware messing around with her.
Okay. And then the last thing I'm going to say, too, is like, you said you're a leader. People can reach out to you to form a business, right? Specifically in education, specifically around consulting. If you had to, if you had the opportunity to collaborate with anyone, who would it be and why? And also, if you had another type of business, what would it be? If you didn't do education, what would you do?
Okay. So if I had an opportunity to collaborate with someone,
anyone,
I really don't have any one individual in mind.
Like, other than...
Yeah.
Thank you, which we collaborated very much.
I'm kind of like one of those people that just goes where the energy is.
Okay, so who inspires you then?
Yeah.
Oh. Who's that person that you're like, this person is a leader? You can say Dr. Martin Luther King because it's
that.
Monday.
No,
you
no.
definitely
I'm
have
gonna
to.
Tell you who inspires me? People in Buffalo who lived under this system for their whole lives and still get up in the morning and have sense of self.
Yeah, I always say you have to
make
have
something happen.
You have
That's
to,
what inspires me.
You have to feel the sun in your heart, I tell my son. Because also statistically, and people don't realize how this affects our health, our overall health, we're one of the grayest cities in America.
No sunlight. Get your vitamin D.
Right. And I think one of the things that's important is take a holistic approach at what mental health means. So take time to understand what are the things that you're feeding to your body, good water, good food, and also take time to understand what is the purpose of positive motion and thought. Because I really think that prayer and positive thought is something that can literally propel you forward, but you have to deliberately take the time to isolate those moments and plan, correct?
Oh, yeah. Your cells respond to your thoughts.
Okay, so
every cell in your body responds to your attitude and how you see things.
You said cell. I thought you meant S-E-L-L and then
nope.
You're okay.
I mean,
you can see where my mind is going.
That could work.
I'm like, okay, my sales are
for
myself.
I think we might have a t-shirt in that.
Yeah, I have t-shirts to come.
Happy sales, increase sales.
We really, really, really need to also tell people where they can reach you, because I think that your journey is one that's really interesting. Talk about you being a single dad before that was like a thing.
Oh, I mean, you know, what is there to say about that? Like,
what,
why do we
the truth?
Talk about patriarchy? Why
no.
do we have to hold up
Let's
a
not.
Man for doing what he's supposed to do?
Because I think I'm really
Dads
proud.
Dads do what they're supposed to do.
I think I'm really proud of you because
like
of your age. I think that when you told me your story, right,
mm-hmm.
and I came to know how young you became a father and what a privilege that was when you talk about your son, right, who we love, just inspiring people just to be like, hey, things like that sometimes throw people off course, but yeah. I think it made you a stronger educator, did it not?
Oh, most definitely. I mean, so...
How old are you when you became
a dad? I was 19
dad?
When my son was born.
Whoop, whoop.
Yep, 19. But thankfully, you know, I had a mother, Shirley Green, sisters, Amara Green, Latia Green, who took care of my son for 2 years while I finished college.
Oh, wonderful.
So, you know, they raised him in those 2 years, and then I would come home in the summer and be a dad and go back to school. But when I got home, it was all me. And I mean, you know, it's, you got to learn patience when you have a child.
Yeah.
And when I graduated undergrad, I went into a classroom of seventh and eighth grade students in an alternative school in Rochester, New York.
Whose energy probably reflected the environment.
Well,
in which
they was looking a lot like me, actually.
And me.
So,
who are you?
You know, it was, I think everything, you can learn from anything. You just need to pay attention.
Okay, last three minutes. What is the role of empathy for educators? How important is that, and where should they demonstrate that?
Well,
see, you wanted me to ask you questions. What's up?
So, let's go. Empathy, right? So it is how you connect with others, right?
Okay.
So I'm gonna notch that up and call it love, right? Let's not dance around what it needs to be. It
Please.
Needs to be love. You
Please.
Can't be an educator.
They see me looking
and not love
okay.
the people you teach.
All right, that's fair. You also, I think, have to love education. My son is a young educator. He's a published author. You already know the vibes.
Yes.
Shout out to my baby's book. You should buy it on Amazon. But also, I think he loves to instruct, and he's always like this at the board. Did you always know you wanted to be an educator, or did people just flock to you and be like, instruct me?
No, I always had a thirst and a passion for knowledge.
It's fantastic.
A thirst and a passion.
Who was
for
your
knowledge.
Favorite educator? Who was someone that affected you, impacted you?
Okay, well, I went to school 53, the Phi 3 High, for all those people who really know.
What? I don't.
That's
me.
Okay. It's all right.
Help me. What is school that?
School 53, Community okay. School 53.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Rare, Wohlers, Glenwood, Cold Springs. What's up?
Okay.
Nan Woods, big shout out to Nan Woods.
She's
a principal.
A
principal,
okay.
African American principal.
So she impacted you.
Oh yeah, miss it. Well, she sure did impact me with her words and her hands.
That is where we will close the show. Thank you, Buffalo Public
Mr.
Schools,
McCarley,
for your
all of them.
Hey, Norm, did you have a question for the gentleman?
I did have a question before y'all close. First of all, Will, I just want to just say to you, man, kudos to you, brother, doing his thing.
Appreciate it.
Holding it down in school, young man taking care of his children. And you know, I'm just proud of you, man.
They old now.
You did a good job. The interview's been great.
Thank you.
But I'd like to ask you, my wife is, she's got her own consulting company, and she's got her own LLC. How do you utilize that particular skill set to make money? Mm-hmm. I don't really even know, you know, what you exactly do or how you make, but how would she utilize that to make money?
Okay. So first of all, let me put my information out there.
Yeah, put your information out there.
MrWillGreen2@gmail.com. Mr. Will Green 2. That's MrWill Green, like the color, GREEN, the number 2, @gmail.com.
Got it.
Shoot
sir.
Me a message.
Got it.
The key to, especially for black and brown folks, mm-hmm. that's why I love Talia for putting on this show.
Hashtag black and brown.
Yes.
Business is for the win.
The key for black and brown folks with skills and abilities is getting an entrance point in the door. And once you get in the door, then you get to show what you truly can do. So for your wife, she needs to expand her network and talk to the right people. All right. And that
possibly
means
you.
Yeah. And that means people who are not just in it to fatten their pockets. They in it to create a community of folks who can do what we were born to do.
All right. Brother.
And that's where we're going to end.
Norm,
thank you.
Yes.
And shout out to your wife, who's a lovely individual.
You know, so Norm, me and him are kind of related.
That's why I was like, Don't even start me. This is the end of my show. Norm, I love you.
Man, seems like Norm is related or no,
we are family picnic every year.
Good day.
Good day,
Buffalo. Because I literally asked him, I was like, do you know them?
Will.
He was like, nah.
I don't know them.
I was like, I son primo.
You just hit me with some stuff.
They told me they didn't even know each other. Listen.
Humphreys, McCarters.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Shout out to all your entire family. Black and Brown Business for the win. Reach out to Mr. Green if you want to learn about educational consulting, if you want to learn about coaching, if you want to learn about leadership, and if you want to learn about his specific experience. You already know Black and Brown Business for the win. This is another episode of Talia Talks, 2 Favorite Morning Show.